Thank you, Chair. Thank you.
DAC and DECO, members of the different cultural groupings, I can see Arterial here, Rights Associates and the others, the intellectuals as well as the respectable bureaucrats of our government, you're most welcome. Angela, you are here up in the stream in which you are made to swim and to lead. We welcome you here. The only problem that we actually have is that we always do not have ample time to say the things we want to say, and consequently, we only touch things in broad generalities when it is very necessary to get to the nitty-gritties of what we're actually talking about. But before I do, I want to start with African proverbs. As long as the history of hunting is written by hunters, it will always favor human beings. It is not time for animals to rewrite their histories. Talking about hunting, we say when the large wooden-handled axe came into the forest, trees applauded, saying, at least the handle is one of us. They never understood your colonialism. Talking about old people, we say when an old person dies, it's like a library burning down. I suppose when a child dies, is like a website wiped out. Talking about communication, we say the goat that breaks the drum must pay with its own skin. We hold a high premium on communication. A group of trees break the angry wind, but the tree that towers above the rest is broken by the wind. I just wanted to echo that the conference that was organized in Addis Ababa that Simpiwe was talking about was quite a very, very fruitful one. I happened to be the person that facilitated the discussions in there. A contribution that was made by very specific people, Murera of Mozambique, and Lumumba, who you all know around in here, who spent sleepless in the night working actually onto the program, need to be specifically mentioned. But anyway, my task is a very simple one of speaking more about reclamation. We are talking about cultural renaissance. An act of a renaissance is an act of reclamation. We are reclaiming something that actually belongs to us, and we need to say exactly what it is that we seek. Colonial discourse marginalized African knowledge system with adverse consequences for the colonized. The colonized ceased to be a subject of his or her own histories and became the construct of the dominant colonizer. During this hegemonic phase, the African accepted the colonizers' complete entire system of values, attitudes, morality, and institutions. Even after the attainment of independence and new regimes disdained African knowledge systems and values. And in search of new paradigms for change, it is crucial that acts of recovery and diversification of sources of knowledge be embarked upon. The reclamation project, that one of the Renaissance we are suggesting, acknowledge that there's no past that can be recovered in its pristine forms. The paper that I'm giving here further argues that the concept of the African Renaissance is not new. It traces it through the earlier cultural Renaissance movement, as Angela had actually touched upon. But then we are saying it's a cultural Renaissance. But what is culture to start with? We gloss over these issues. According to Mugiwa Diongo, culture is the product of people's history, but it also reflects that history and embodies the whole set of values by which a people view themselves in their place, in time, and in space. When you call on to recall a culture, therefore, means to recall a way of life, to recall a people's history. All our work of art and science the visible and the invisible creation that our people have produced since time immemorial are expressions of our culture. To recall a culture is to recall the means of self-definition, our identity. We must not allow others to interfere with the formulation of our own agendas, to create a space in which we speak freely, and to create institutions that are relevant to our situation is a very sacrosanct act. Wade Nobles, the African-American thinker, defines culture as a process by which people give a general design for living and how we pattern our reality. I think we're at war. He also defines the aspects of culture as ideology, as ethos, and as worldview. And the factors of culture are ontology, the essence of our being, cosmology, our relationship with the heavenly bodies, and axiology, the issues of our morality. And the manifestations of culture consist in behavior, values, and attitudes. And apart from giving a broad identification, culture builds on shared experiences and a collective sense of cultural identity. It makes possible the creation of shared symbols, shared meanings, and acts as a primary source for collective consciousness. And it is that which makes possible for us to construct our national consciousness. One of the weapons that we actually used to describe our own culture was the issue of religion. Therefore, we can't talk about cultural renaissance without touching on the issues of religion. According to Kamalu, African religions include cosmology, science, medicine, healing, science in particular, art, psychology, philosophy, all integrated into a holistic system of thought. Indeed, African thought is based on the holism of life, the interconnectedness, the interrelationship, and the interdependence of all phenomena. The issue of interconnectedness, interdependence, interrelationship is a language of quantum mechanics that overthrew the idea of the Newtonian binary opposites. And yet the question of quantum physics is a question that expresses African indigenous knowledge systems, which we study to understand and to grasp. Indeed, African thought is based on holism, and on that interconnectedness and interrelationship of interdependence and the oneness of peoples. The beginning of an attempt to create an agenda for African cultural renaissance must first examine four historical moments that were identified by Walter Rodney. The reconstruction of the nature of development in Africa before the coming of the Europeans. Reconstruction of the nature of development which took place in Europe before their expansion abroad. Analysis of Africa's contribution to Europe present development state. Fourthly, analysis of Europe's contribution to Africa's underdeveloped state. So the act, therefore, of the recovery of the Renaissance need to address that. We are using here the term reconstruction, like we use RDP, reconstruction and development list, which we jettison. Reconstruction implies an interruption, a destruction of something valuable that must be rebuilt. Development refers to a process through which individuals in society and society as a whole engages in programs for the attainment of increased skills, capacity, greater freedom, creativity, responsibility, and the material well-being of the people of that the society. Needless to say that Africa, like many other countries, has developed its own societies, its cultures to meet its needs. It has developed its own infrastructure that serves its people long before its contact with Europe. There are no longer any disputes as to where life originated and where civilization first emerged. A recent discovery points out that 3.1 million years ago, a skeleton was discovered here in South Africa that kind of places the origin of human beings in here. Centuries before contact with the West, in some areas, agriculture was advanced. There was terracing, crop rotation, green manuring, regulated swamp farming, mixed farming methods were practiced. And yes, you know, in West Africa, they had a four-day week, which today the modern world is trying to go back to the four-day week, you know, because they realize the power of doing that. And yet, we have simply become nothing else but the photocopies of European thoughts. How many of you here know that a hand axe, the first technological invention in the world, dated 600,000 years BP, was found here in South Africa? And the 27,500 before Christ, a drawing of an antelope was found in Apollo Caves in Namibia, sub-Saharan Africa. And yet, we at the South Sub-Saharan Africa, Mali, Bomi, Ethiopia, Ghana, Nubia, South Africa, South Africa where Tulamela, Mapungubwe, Mahabeng, where many of the civilizations that actually thrive in here. But because we have got universities in South Africa and in Africa, but we do not have African universities, some of these knowledges are not actually being known. What is Africa's contribution to the development of Europe? Of course, we know that people like King Leopold owned the whole of the Congo as their own little in the terrain and all their parts. The Balkanization of Africa. But now, let us come up with a very few items here. When we talk about the issues of cultural renaissance, I just wanted to touch here. They were central to the teachings of race pride and the love of their country. There are a number of African American people in the 19th century who were somebody like Reverend David Vincent, changed his name from David Vincent, he became Reverend Bajola Abebe. William J. Davis took the name of Oranso Ratuke Faduna, to name a few. Already they were jettisoning their own names and taking their own names of Africa. J.H. Kesley Hayford emphasized the need for an African university to be situated in the interior of the country, in the heartlands of the people's culture. His wife, Adelaide, revolutionized women's dress by setting an example of being dressed only in African costumes for all occasions. In other words, that Black Consciousness Movement of Azania was a precursor both to South Africa, and this was taking place in West Africa in the 19th century. Edward William Blyden, in his famous speech, The Return of the Exile and the West African Church, in 1891, called on the people to organize an independent church free from foreign control. He realized that Christianity was emasculating our cultures as well as our belief system. The question then arises, who is alienated from our culture? Is it my grandmother, my mother, my sister, all the uneducated, barbaric people, or is it the learned people who are actually sitting around in here? When we look at our children, we say, that is a lost generation, yet we never ask ourselves, if they are our children, how did we lose them? So in other words, we need to be neat and clear what it is. We are linking the question of African cultural renaissance to the issue of Pan-Africanism. Africa adopted Western-style economic and political structures that did not suit African conditions. Economically and agriculture, Africa continued to be a producer of cash crops for the Western world. Everything that we actually tried to do was to serve somebody else rather than getting ourselves on it. The issue that was touched upon, the issue of language. How many of our children who are brilliant mathematicians and scientists fail to do so because they do not understand the language of instruction? Recently, I was chairing a ministerial advisory panel on the development of African languages in higher education. And we went to all the 23 universities in South Africa, talking to management, to the staff, as well as to the students. As to why management is not doing it, what staff is doing, what are the students saying? Staff says, we can't teach it completely because we do not have the lexicographies and the dictionaries. And the student says, what dictionaries and lexicographies did British and German missionaries have when they translated the Bible? There is a simple basic question. And there's also an argument that the reason why African languages cannot be languages of scholarship, they cannot be languages of business, you know, because one word in one word in English is a whole sentence in indigenous languages. And one of the students said to me, Professor, I said, yes, he says, in your language, what is this? I said, Ibunzi. He says, one way. He says, in English, what is it? I said, forehead, which means this is the head that is in front. So what is this? Oh, this is an elbow. It is a bow that is L-shaped. Who has got sentences actually for languages? Because we do not know who indeed we are. We have entered now what is described as an African century, the century of the African Renaissance. The Renaissance is a rebirth that requires us to re-examine our knowledge system anew with a view to extracting some lessons from our own past. I've said it earlier on that, say, in my language, the word for time is isi ka. Isn't it? Isi Kati. The name for space is Umkati. The root of Umkati and the root of Iskati is a singular one, indivisible. Therefore, you could not have had a Newton being born in Africa about space and time. There will be space-time continuum, which is a space-time continuum in Umkati and Iskati. And because we have abandoned our languages, we are lost. We do not know exactly who it is. Makandeyane Kantuli at the age of 97 said, the secret of ancient wisdom is in words and their forgotten meanings. Let me, as I move towards the close, then to conceptualize the idea. Now, when you count in your language, can you count up to 10? They will help you.
In my language?
Yeah. Is it ready? Okay. If you have your calling card box like this, this good one like me, you put one, isn't it? Yes, it is. I put another one. How many? Zimazigagi? I put another one, Zimazigagi? This is wrong. You know, that's how Europeans count. Whether it's in 30, 20, or anything, in African concepts, you add up to 5. When you come to 6 and 7, you are no longer adding, you are symbolizing. After symbolizing, you subtract. Isn't it? Now, when we say now Tiela, which means we are crossing over. Super, we are indicating. When we say Robedi, we are minusing 2. Robon, we are minusing 1. When you come to 10, we resolve. So when we talk about cultural recoveries, we are talking about serious things. I won't just move towards that. Now, what is happening now is that I use an iPhone 6, right? Seeing poor, they use this strawberry. Right, he used a strawberry. In my language, usimpiwe unefoni. Godwa uprofessor Ntuli unefoni gazi. That gazi of my phone means the awesomeness of my phone, isn't it? Now, let us dwell on this gazi business and this awesomeness. At home, in Nkosi, gazi. That means my wife is an awesome king. My daughter is in daughter, Gazi, is an awesome man. My aunt is umalume, Gazi. Isn't it? And the word for woman, umfazi, it is constructed out of two of the most powerful concepts in the world, the concept of death and the concept of knowledge. And yet, we have things like, a man is the head of the family. So I think the idea then for us to meet Article 5 of the Charter 2063, you know, Charter, we have got to begin to reconceptualize our attitude towards our languages. We have to conceptualize the issue of the imagery that we get in our writings, of the arts that we do. What we also do not actually realize, say, what's in here we should have emphasized is that one of the things that we said when we were in Addis Ababa, the visual artists were saying the reclamation of our artworks that were taken, you know, by Europe and America need to be repatriated. Why is it that in 1977, during the FESTAC Arts and Culture Festival, there was an ivory mask from Yoruba country that was adopted by Africa to become a symbol for Africa, that was held by the Brits. The Brits refused to surrender that piece. We had to use a duplicate in order to do it. It speaks about the potency of the power of the visual arts. We are here in South Africa, slaughtered areas. It's flag plus, it is Isowe, Tushabville, Bisho, Nyanga, Langa, but you're not going to see any monument. You go to America, every square mile in Washington, D.C., you know, carries up a statue, a monument of something. That's a way by which they massively come with a program of social cohesion. Whatever their differences are, their images bring them actually together. We need, therefore, to seriously think. Let's be honest with one another. Our national development plan, which is hundreds of pages in itself, has only got half a page on art and culture. The 2063 itself has very little to do with art and culture.